Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to all of you, and welcome to the folks on Facebook who are watching us live. We're grateful to have you today. Today we're doing something we haven't done in some time, and I can't remember doing it exactly this way ever. We're having an adult baptism, which is great. Daniel Long is going to be baptized. We're also having his wife join by confirmation, along with Sally Brown and Grayson, wherever Grayson is, there she is, Grayson Johnson Duarte, and then Judith Mychalk, who is confirmed, is going to join as a reaffirmation of faith. So we got all this going on in one part of the service, so we'll see if we can pull this all together. But they were part of my adult instruction class that we just got done a couple weeks ago, and they wanted to all join at the same time, so we're doing it all at the same time. I want to thank Pastor Michael Albrecht, a member of our church who's going to be assisting me from time to time, and today he's assisting with the liturgy so that I don't have to stand quite as much. I also want to thank String Coalition, who will be playing this morning here shortly, for playing today. As far as announcements go, You will note that this afternoon there are two special group meetings. The Men of Peace will be meeting at 5 o'clock out at Kelsey Melly's home in Robinson. And the Women of Peace, a brand new group, will be meeting at Deborah Rick's home, Marshall and Deborah Rick's home, which is in China Spring. So we'll be spread out here. But that's for any of the women of the congregation. So we'll have both a men's group, which has been going on for some time, and now a brand new woman's group. I'd ask that you would stand and greet your neighbor, and then after that, I'm going to have you sit back down so we can listen to String Coalition.
I thought number one would surely be me. Thought I would be what I wanted to be. Thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought I could do a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high and the valley's too wide. Down on my knees I learned to stand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. From now on, I think I'll make Jesus my all. When I'm in trouble, on him I will call. If I don't trust him, I'd be less than a man, 'cause I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high and the valley's too wide. Down on my knees, I learn to stand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
The rite of holy baptism is on page 268 in the hymnal. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations,
baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit."
The last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved." The Apostle Peter has written, "Baptism now saves you." The Word of God also teaches that we are all conceived and are born sinful, under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. When be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. The Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to atone for the sin of the whole world, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Daniel Jeffrey Long, receive the sign of the Holy Cross both upon your forehead and upon your heart, to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the Crucified. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, according to your strict judgment, you condemned the unbelieving world through the flood. Yet according to your great mercy, you preserved believing Noah and his family, 8 souls in all. You drowned hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his hosts in the Red Sea. Yet you led your people Israel through water on dry ground, foreshadowing this washing of your holy baptism, the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and a lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold the angel according to your boundless mercy, and bless them with a true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood all sin in him, which he has inherited from Adam, which he himself has committed sins, will be drowned and die. Grant to be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian Church, being separated from the multitude of unbelievers, and serving your name at all times with a fervent spirit and a joyful hope, so that with all believers in your promise, will be declared worthy of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you please join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, preserve your coming in and your going out from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen. I'm going to speak to the whole class. Daniel, Sally, Grayson, Corey, and Judith, do you renounce the devil? Do you renounce all his works? Do you renounce all his ways? Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried? He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. You believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. You intend to continue steadfast in this confession in church, to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it. And do you desire to be a member of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and of this congregation? Do you support the work our Lord has given to this congregation with your prayers, time, treasures, and talents? Upon this your confession, I, in the name of this congregation, extend to you the right hand of fellowship and love, acknowledging you as members of our congregation, inviting you to receive the Lord's Supper with us, and to participate in all the blessings of salvation which God has given to his church, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you new birth of water and the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God and Father, we thank and praise you that you graciously preserve and enlarge your family, and have granted Daniel the new birth and holy baptism, made a member of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you that as he has now become your child, you would keep him in his baptismal grace, that according to your good pleasure, he may faithfully grow to lead a godly life, to the praise and honor of your holy name, and finally with all your saints, obtain the promised inheritance in heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
The introit is drawn from Psalm 48. Let us pray together. The one who endures to the end will be saved. Let Mount Zion be glad. Let the daughters of Judah rejoice because of your judgments. Walk about Zion. Go around her. Number her towers. Consider well her ramparts. Go through her citadels, that you may tell the next generation that this is God, our God, forever and ever. He will guide us forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The one who endures to the end will be saved. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Set us be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, by your bountiful goodness, release us from the bonds of our sins, which by reason of our weakness we have brought upon ourselves, that we may stand firm until the day of our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading today is from the book of Daniel, chapter 12. At that time shall arise Michael, the great prince who has charge of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never has been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time your people shall be delivered, everyone whose name shall be found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above. And those who turn many to the righteousness, like the stars forever and ever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's epistle is from Hebrews chapter 10. Every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord, I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds," then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with the pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." This is the word of the Lord.
I sense his presence, and I knew this was a place where love abounds. For this is the temple Jehovah God abides here. We are standing in his presence on holy ground.
We are standing on holy ground, and I know all around.
presence on holy ground. In his presence there is joy beyond all measure. And at his feet, peace of mind can still be found. And if you have a need, I know he has the answer. Reach out and claim it, for we are standing on holy ground.
We are standing on holy ground, and I know
Gospel for the 25th Sunday after Pentecost is recorded by St. Mark in the 13th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings." And Jesus said to him, "Do you see these great buildings? There will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." And as he sat on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign when all these things are about to be accomplished?" And Jesus began to say to them, "See that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. And when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. These are but the beginning of the birth pains. But be on your guard, for they will deliver you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them. And the gospel must first be proclaimed to all nations. And when they bring you to trial and deliver you over, do not be anxious beforehand what you are to say, but say whatever is given you in that hour, for it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. And brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Be seated.
Will the children please come forward?
Good morning. I have a big book here, don't I? Kind of old looking, isn't it? Now, some of the pages aren't quite right, and it's kind of scraggly a little bit. But every week, almost, not quite, but every week, I use this book. You have any idea what might be in it? Pictures? Nope, not a picture one, I don't think. Everything's just written. But what's written in here are the names of all the people who have been baptized here at Peace, or who have been confirmed, or who have been married here, or who have been buried here. And so I have a record here of baptisms, and I write in there the names of people. And let's see here. I wish I could find a few of yours. Here's one. Come here, Ellie. It says right here, Ellie Faith Williams. So your name's written in a book, okay? And I bet you if I look a little farther down, I'll find your brother. Let's see here. Where is your brother? There he is. Come here, Luke. See, there's Luke's name. And right after Luke's name is Cannon's name. Your name's right after that. He's over there. So your names are written in this book. And that means that you were baptized here. No, right? You weren't baptized here. You were baptized somewhere else. So your name's not in this book. I'm sorry. But your dad's name, Riker, your dad's name's going to be written in this book. Because he was baptized here, and your mom and dad were married here, so their names are written in this book. And lots of the other people who are here in the church have their names written in this book, one place or another. And in the book of Daniel, in the Old Testament lesson, it talks about a book that's even more important than this one. Now, this one here keeps our official records. We keep it on computers, we have all that sort of stuff. But I keep it still handwritten so that we have in one place all of the records of things that people happened here. And Pastor Bergman wrote a number of people's names in here years ago. And before that, Pastor Mike. And whoever's pastor next will write in the same book. And it'll always be a record of who was members of the church here. But in Daniel, it talks about another book. And it's a book that's going to be opened on the last day. And in that book, and it's a book kept in heaven, it's going to list everybody's name, including yours, Riker, who have been made members of God's kingdom through baptism and belief in Jesus Christ. Everybody's name. It's the some places called the Book of Life or the Book of the Lamb. The Book of Life, because it says who's going to live forever. The Book of the Lamb, because the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, is the one who gives us the right to have our name written in that book. He's the one that died for us and rose again for us. And the Book of Daniel says, on that last day, he's going to be reading out the names. Now, we had five people join our church this morning. Can you imagine how long the list is going to be? All the names of all the people of all time are being read out. Pretty neat, though. It's going to be pretty neat to stand in heaven and hear names of people who lived a long time ago, like Peter, James, and John, or people who lived, you know, maybe not so long ago, like your great-grandparents or somebody that you kind of miss from time to time. But your name will be written there too. Because of the blood of Jesus, your name will be there because you are God's child. And you will rise again, Daniel says, to new life, to righteousness, to live with Jesus and the other believers and the angels themselves forever.
think what they're keeping in heaven. You can go sit down. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text is drawn from the gospel reading from Mark chapter 13. And as he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings." And Jesus said to him, "Do you see these great buildings? There will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." Must have been late in the evening. He'd been teaching all day, Jesus had, with the disciples present and others. He'd been contending all day as well with the various religious groups, leaders, Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and others, all of whom were looking for a way to trap him and trick him and to get him to say something false. And as it's evening and they're traveling out of Jerusalem back to Bethany, where they were staying a few miles away, must have been the evening sun that was bouncing off the temple that got the attention of the individual disciple. And he saw there, off in the distance, the temple. And the temple was gleaming. Now, up on top of the roof of our church is a steeple that has gold on it. If you come here real early in the morning or right in the evening, either way, you have to be standing in the right place. The gold just is luminous when the sun is hitting it just right. And last Sunday morning, I was here early enough to see a bald eagle perched up there on the cross. And that's not the first time I've seen that. But it's a marvelous thing what gold does when the sun's hitting it just right. And King Herod the Great, or maybe not so great, had spent a lot of time and energy and money expanding and enlarging the temple, making it a showplace, a wonder of the world, it was considered. This magical, marvelous place with stones as big as freight cars. You know freight cars on a train? Stones that big, a single stone, moved into place, and they were dry-fitted, no mortar, each one of them stacked perfectly level on top of the one below it. It's amazing feats of architecture and building. And this disciple, whichever one it was, looks back and he sees this and he's stunned by how beautiful this is. And all Jesus can say is, well, do you see these great buildings? There will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down. And I don't know what they thought of that, but it couldn't have been real good. They went immediately when they get to the Mount of Olives, which is where this picture shows them as being on the opposite side. You go down through a valley and then up on top of another ridge. When they get over there, they ask him, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, tell us when these things will be and what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished. Okay, Lord, if all of that's going to be torn down, when's that going to happen? How's that going to happen? Give us specifics. Give us exactly what's going to be. Well, Jesus answers them, but it's kind of on the basis of what is often known as need to know. You know what need to know is? It's kind of a military term. They tell one group, but they don't. If you don't need to know it, they don't tell someone else. So some people know everything, but most people only know a part of whatever they're doing. And they're told, you know, go up that hill and take that mountain. They're not, no need to know why they're going up there necessarily or what the larger strategy is that's going on 40 miles away. It's just you stand here, you go up there, and you take that. That's what you need to know. So Jesus decides to give them what they need to know. He says, first of all, there's going to be false shepherds, false leaders, false Christs, people who are going to claim to be like Jesus, but who really aren't. See that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name saying I am he, and they will lead many astray. So the first thing he says to them, watch out who your teachers are. Watch out who speaks to you in the future, because there will be plenty of false ones who are claiming to be Jesus and aren't, who are going to be claiming that they know from God more than you do, but they don't, or who aren't basing their teaching on the words of Christ that the Holy Spirit would inspire people like John and Peter, along with Matthew and Mark and Paul, to write down. This is what Jesus really says. He says, watch out, there's going to be deceivers who are going to come along. And if you get farther into the New Testament, farther along in the history of even the early church, there's already deceivers that have to be dealt with in places like Galatia and in Corinth. Just watch out. That you need to know. You need to know that there's going to be false teachers. Some of them may even claim to be Jesus himself returned. He says, second thing he says you need to know that there's going to be trouble in this world. That this world is not going to be the easy place to live. For instance, he goes on to say, you will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but don't be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. These are but the beginning of the birth pains. Braxton Hicks, they call those, I think. The beginning of the birth pains. Just things that are warning you that there's something coming here. So when we hear about an earthquake someplace, or a famine someplace, or a war someplace, and let's face it, you just turn on the TV, you can hear about that every day. We should be thinking something is coming. That this earth that we live on, that God gave us, which has been fallen because of sin, which is not the way God intended it because of sin, will one day change. That what we think are pretty permanent, things like mountains and oceans and rivers, will all change. They'll all be gone, and a new heaven and a new earth will be created. We're told a number of places in Isaiah and in 2 Peter. There will be a complete change. So what we hear here, when we hear about all these troubles, and they're real painful, and if you're in a famine, or if you had an earthquake, or if you're in the middle of a war, these are serious matters. But so are birth pains. They hurt. They hurt badly, I'm told, I should say. I've seen it, but I haven't done it. But it's just the beginning. There's more coming. A pastor who was a pastor here in the Texas district at one time, he was in San Antonio for a long time. His name was Dr. Guido Merkins. He liked to explain how this kind of works this way. He said, you know, when you were inside your mother could talk to you. And she could tell you about the world that was around you. She could tell you about your father. She could tell you about the house you lived in. She could tell you about the trees and the flowers and the mountains and the sea. But could you really conceive of them? No, it's only when you went through the birth pains and came out that you could understand the world we're in now. And Dr. Mertens used to make the point that while Jesus tells us a few things about the world to come, we can't understand it yet until we go through these birth pains in our born again. Now, Jesus had told Nicodemus, unless you're born again of water and the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. This morning, Daniel was born again of water and the Spirit. He can see the kingdom of God. Those of you who are baptized will see the kingdom of God. We actually know what's on the other side. We're going to get to see it. That we need to know. And we need to remember, for us, it's not a terrifying event. It's not something we need to be afraid of. But here now, Jesus said, you need to know it's difficult. He also says you have to be ready to speak the gospel in sometimes difficult circumstances. But be on your guard, for they will deliver you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues. And you'll stand before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them. And the gospel must first be proclaimed to all nations. And when they bring you to trial and deliver you over Do not be anxious beforehand what you are to say, but say what is ever given you in that hour, for it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. So he tells them, you need to know that you may very well have to defend your faith. And the gospel has to be preached to all nations. One of the things we need to know is that we have a global call to teach to people wherever they are, in whatever language they speak, in whatever place they live, and whatever government system they have, or whatever economic status they have. We have a calling to proclaim the gospel to them, and sometimes that's going to lead God's people to have to stand before councils or kings or religious leaders or others, and they're going to challenge you, why do you speak what you're speaking? And he says, don't worry about that. You need to know that the Holy Spirit's going to help you at that time. But you're not up there by yourself. Don't worry about that. He'll give you the words to speak. But you got to be ready to speak and not try to run away from it. Because the gospel must be proclaimed to all nations, everywhere. We can't just say, well, that's good enough for America. We're out, as long as we cover our area, a little bit of world, the rest of it can literally go to hell. That's not right. We have a requirement and a promise that the gospel would be proclaimed to all nations. And so God's going to do that somehow or other. He's going to proclaim the gospel to all nations. And then he says, you need to know that even within families, brother will deliver brother over to death, and father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. Even within families, there's going to be conflict over Christianity. Sometimes good Christians raise children to be good Christians and then they walk away. Or sometimes people come to faith and their other members of the family have no interest in it, and they treat you poorly for it. He says, that's going to happen. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. The one who doesn't give up and say, well, you know, it's just too hard. It's just too difficult. You know, I know one of the most difficult situations to be in is the one where your spouse is not a believer and you are. If your spouse is not a believer and you are every day being challenged about your faith. It's a tough place to be. And if you're in that situation, know that you will be able to endure until the end. That nothing will take you out of God's hand. And yet, it's going to be a struggle. It's going to be difficult. But God's not going to give up on you. Now, he's saying all this in this context of tearing down his building. What's that all about? We're seeing it in a context, first of all, that they would see, some of them anyways, the actual destruction of that building. That whole complex, in fact, in 70 AD, some 40 years or so from then, the Romans would come and literally level the place. They would come in anger because the Jews had rebelled yet again. It wasn't their first rebellion. And they were going to tear it down. And it's not been rebuilt. Oh, there's a little bit of the wall that held up the outside of the building on the western side, known as the Wailing Wall, that's still there. But that was like the retaining wall, the one that holds back the dirt so everything doesn't fall down. The rest of it's gone. And he's saying, you're going to see this. All this effort, all this attempt to glorify God with a building is not going to be there. But then he'd already said on another occasion, destroy this temple, and on 3 days, I will raise it. And within just a day or two, that's what they're going to bring as the charge against Jesus. They're going to say, well, he spoke against the temple. He said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it. And John is helpful enough in his gospel to say, you know what that was? The temple? That was Jesus himself. That Jesus was going to be destroyed. The place where God came to meet his people. That's what the temple was there for. It wasn't there to make Herod a great name. It wasn't there for all those sacrifices alone. It was there because the one who will make the single sacrifice, the only sacrifice that can forgive sins, that's the point of the epistle, that one would come to it and there be sacrificed to the Father on our behalf and destroyed. And then on the third day, rise again. And on the third day, come from the tomb. And on the third day, appear and show himself to people like Peter and James and John and Andrew and so many others. So that they would know for certain that while times would be difficult, salvation was at hand. Forgiveness was there. And that's what we hang on to too. Now, at the end of this passage, in Mark 13, past what we read this morning, we have this. But concerning that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. We don't have the need to know what day this is going to occur. We don't have the need to know what time of the day. We don't have the need to know what month or year. He says, no one knows. The angels don't know. The Son doesn't know. Jesus is saying, I don't even know. But only the Father knows. But he goes on to say, be on guard, keep awake, for you do not know when that time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake. For you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake. We need to know that he's going to return. We don't know when, but we need to know that he's going to return, and we have to stay awake. We can't kind of lose track of that. Unfortunately, I think many Americans today are forgetting that we're going to have to stand before the throne of God. That someday we're going to stand there and they're going to take out the real book, not this meek copy of it, and read the names of those who were baptized and believed in Christ at the moment of their death. And they're forgetting that every one of us will stand there. And Daniel says some will be raised to life and others to everlasting condemnation. We're forgetting that we have to stand before Jesus one day, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, who died for every single person, but who some people, unfortunately, are rejecting. They're putting more important things in their mind ahead of Christ. And instead of gathering together, they've become ones who have another habit, Hebrews says, of not gathering together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, he says, until the day of our Lord. So it's our job, as part of this proclamation, to be encouraging one another to remember we're going to stand before the throne of God. And then what happens? Well, then he tells us this. And on that day they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. Heaven and earth will pass away, he says, but my words will never pass away. So he's going to gather us up, and we're going to stand before the throne of God, and we need to know that. And we need to put that into practice, and we need to help others to know that. And we need to know that life here is not always going to be easy. And we need to know that in all things, Christ will be with us. And while we don't know what day or hour he's going to return, we do know he is coming. And he is coming soon. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Will you speak the words of the Apostles' Creed?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
In our prayers this morning, we want to remember Wanda Barker, Mary Beth Michaelis' cousin, who's hospitalized with COVID-related pneumonia in Dallas. And we want to remember the family and friends of Mary Compton, longtime member of St. Mark's, who passed away this week. We also want to offer prayers of thanksgiving for Vicki Brown's sisters, Linda and Sheila, as they continue to recuperate. And then also for Tom Orman and Riggleman's son, who's recovering from some heart trouble. So let us pray. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. We draw near to you, O Lord, our Heavenly Father, in the confidence of faith, because you have given us a clear conscience and you have washed our bodies with your pure water in the sacrament of holy baptism. Inspire us now to walk in newness of life, eager to worship you, especially as we see the last day drawing near. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Preserve and extend your church throughout the world. Even as we are alerted by wars and rumors of war and famines and earthquakes and false prophets, that every eye will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds when he returns in glory. Lead us to proclaim the gospel with zeal to the ends of the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are ill and those who have requested our prayers, especially for Miley and Wanda and for Linda and Sheila and Tom. We also ask your blessing, your comfort, and your consolation for the family and friends of Mary. And we pray for Pastor Reinierson and for Linda and their family. Please grant him relief from his pain and give him strength to serve you as he continues to serve us here at Peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Uphold all in authority, especially the President and the Congress and the Supreme Court of the United States, the Governor and Legislature of Texas, and our mayors and local officials. May they lead us according to your will and for our good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all police officers, firefighters, paramedics, and security guards who are so often awake while we are sleeping. As they watch and work on behalf of others, grant them diligence in their watching, courage in danger, and competence in emergencies. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, generous Lord, for the fruits of the earth provided by your hand. Supply the needs of all who grow, transport, and sell our food, and move us to share these bountiful gifts with our neighbors in their time of need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all pregnant women and nursing mothers, and for their children, born and unborn. And we pray for our marriages and families, that you will fill our homes with joy and harmony and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for those in nursing homes and healthcare centers, for those who don't get out of their own homes very often anymore. We pray for the sick and the injured, the lonely and the depressed, and those who suffer physical and emotional pain that never seems to go away. Grant them healing of body and mind and patience to endure their afflictions. And we pray for people all over the world who have tested positive for COVID and for all who fear they will. Please bring this pandemic to an end. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our fellow Christians around the world who are suffering persecution or the threat of persecution simply because they confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Uphold them in their pain. Keep them close to you in faith and turn the hearts of those who persecute them to repentance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant these and all our petitions, O God, and whatever else you know that we need, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. O Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
Good morning again. Glad that you could come and worship with me today. Glad that so many of you are here, as well as those who are watching us on the streaming Facebook Live. I want to thank Pastor Albrecht again for assisting today. He and Pastor Bergman will continue to do this, I guess, until I actually retire. So I want to thank them for their willingness to step up and help me with this in the coming weeks. I also want to thank again String Coalition for playing this morning. It was beautiful, as is expected. I don't expect any less because it's always that way. So great. Thankful. I'm going to let all the other groups go here and say what they have to say, and then we'll see what else is left to be picked up.
Good morning. First of all, I want to remind the Peace Ensemble that we are rehearsing immediately after this service, and there's lots of other people that need the space this morning, so don't get lost. Let's get up there and get it done. I'm the bossy one. Some of you may have known that in the past we've had candle stands that we use during the Advent season, but they belong to St. Paul, and they wanted them back, so they got them back. And I still wanted a set for here. So I would like to thank Mike Mirage for making us this beautiful set. You will see them with the candle and the globe and all of that during the Advent season and Christmas season. So we just thank you so much, Mike. They are just gorgeous workmanship. So we really appreciate it. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I want to remind you, next Sunday is our Thanksgiving meal here at the church, so the sign-up list is on the bulletin board. Just kind of a final reminder to get your favorite dish listed on the bulletin board. There's several blanks, but if there's not enough space, just write on the edges, whatever you want to do. Just fill in that piece of paper and make sure you come next Sunday, and we'll have a great fellowship event. Thank you.
I'd like to encourage everyone to stop as you're going out and pick up a bag. Lois has some in the back, and it's for food for the Salvation Army. They always need food, but especially at this time of year. So if you can help, we'd appreciate it. You can bring your food in the parish hall next week, and there's a shelf on the right-hand side as you go in the parish hall for that. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. He takes it every month to Salvation Army.
I'm here as a reminder about today's meeting of the Women of Peace, brand new, formed just as we will be meeting tonight, 5 to 7. If you are a woman in this church, come. You're so invited. It'll be held at my house. Oh, and Marshall's house as well. So we look forward. We look forward to seeing you. 5 to 7. Bring your favorite fingers food. Take care.
Finger food.
Yeah.
Finger food. That's not an easy one to say. Also here shortly, if there's any demand for it, we're going to have acolyte training for young people who have not acolyted in our church. Ann Riggleman's going to run that, and that's going to take place in here right after everyone gets out of here. So I know the choir is going to be singing, and all sorts of things are happening, but we want to make sure that the young people are trained to be acolytes, so we're going to be doing that as well. We have the class in Daniel taking place in the fellowship hall, and of course the 11 o'clock service today, so there's lots on the agenda. But I really want to thank the class that I had this fall. That it was a really good class of people who wanted to learn about the faith. Some brought people because they didn't have someone to bring them, and some came and were members already, and some were not members and wanted to learn, and we are grateful that you went through the class and have joined our congregation, each one of you. The Lord be with you.
And